practice. Are you guys still awake?
Yeah.
Can we do a small exercise where we all stand up? Yes, put our hands in the air. It's easy, you can still track what I'm doing. We're going up again. Cool. Everyone is still awake. Cool. We are on to our next talk. I don't know much about you, so I think we have more time to introduce yourself.
I'm Frank van Langveld, software engineer, data engineer at Royal Flora Holland, doing actually a lot of Python these days, because I'm into data science, and somehow Python got it to be the lingua franca of that field. In the past I did work a lot with Scala, did do a big data with Scala, and basically I try now to get Scala in my daily work as well, and try to get the data science in Scala going. Because of that I also started at Scala Infer, which is probabilistic programming in Scala. So I want to talk a bit about probabilistic programming, since all of you know programming, functional programming. I'm not going to talk about functional programming. Probabilistic programming, which is very non-functional, actually. But the thing it is trying to answer is things like, did it rain? So say we have a model. We have a 20% chance of precipitation, of rain. We have a sprinkler system on the grass. And if it rains, then the sprinkler typically doesn't sprinkle the grass. If it doesn't rain, then the sprinkler has a higher chance of actually sprinkling. And then you have this sprinkler and the rain itself, and there's a probability that the grass is wet. Perhaps it rained only a little, perhaps the sprinkler went on, was only on for a few minutes, and the grass didn't really get wet. So there's not a, it's not a binary thing, it's more a probabilistic thing. So, as you can see, if both the sprinkler and the rain went off, then yes, there's a very high probability that the grass is wet. If neither went off, then the probability that the grass is wet is zero. And there are some other numbers in between. So the thing is now, given that the grass is wet, what is the probability that it rained? Those are the things that probabilistic programming is trying to answer. So it's you have a model that describes how the grass could get wet, and then you have a if you turn it into a probabilistic program, then it can tell you the probability about some of these parameters. So the thing I want to be able to do, I don't want to have these tables of probability and then calculate through them on a piece of paper. I just want to write them down in a program, and that the library or the whatever is behind it. Just do the inference. So here I have the same model, but then written down as a Scala program. As you can see here, I actually sample from a Bernoulli distribution. This is just a binary distribution. That is true for 20% of the time and false for 80% of the time. And I get a Boolean back whether it rained or not. Then I sample from the sprinkler. So if it rained, then there's a 1% probability that the sprinkler actually went off. If it didn't rain, there's a 40% probability. So again, you get a Boolean whether the sprinkler went off. And then finally, we have the large table we saw just now. If we have the rain and the sprinkler, what is the probability that the grass is actually wet? Well, that's basically just this table. We just match on the Boolean values, and we get a probability. And then finally, we say that the grass is wet. So we have an observation, and we can have these probabilities that the grass is wet, given that you have this probability, and we know that it is wet, so you observe a value of true. And then finally, we wanted to know whether it actually rained. So that's the thing we're going to return. So as you can see, this is we're not doing any inference, we're not calculating anything, we're just specifying how could the data be generated. And that's doesn't limit you to anything that's built into a machine learning or a data science toolkit. You can code anything, right? Anything that generates data can be a program like this. So that's the promise of probabilistic programming. You write down how you can generate data, and you then infer what actually happened in your data. And of course, you can also do old school models that have a lot of well-known implementations, and it may be a bit more cumbersome to write them down because it's very explicit. But now you can actually see what's going on. If you do linear regression, for instance, you have an intercept, you have a few regression coefficients, so this is for a two-dimensional x and then a one-dimensional y. And then you have some noise term, so then you have an intercept and you take the inner product of the x factor and the regression coefficients, and then you observe y, and then again this is how you would calculate the parameters of your model. So then of course I need to explain what kind of probability is. So I'm into Bayes. Bayes is basically the full blown probability theory, which I will first explain all the math behind it, or at least a part of the math behind it, and then I will tell you not to worry about it. So bear with me. But I will tell you why we want to have this interpretation of statistics. And the thing is, if you need to make a business decision, such as you have two website variants, A and B, and you want to have the visitor actually click through to some conversion page, then you want to know which one converts better. So if A converts better, if more people actually click through, then you want to keep variant A and you want to drop variant B. The same with advertising. If even though the CTR of B may be more than the CTR, higher than the CTR of A, if the profit of B is a lot less than that of A, then I guess I didn't make a reverse argument. You want to take more things into account. So the thing is, if you know these numbers, then it's very easy to make decisions. You know the exact click-through rate, so you know exactly what to do. But the thing is, you don't know these numbers exactly. You have a big amount of uncertainty, you only have limited data, you don't have exact numbers. So making the business decision is more based on this fuzzy numbers. You have these two variants, A, which has been around for some time, and it has a pretty well-defined click-through rate. It's somewhere between 0.25 and 0.5. And you have variant B, which hasn't seen so many visitors, so it's a much broader distribution, and you don't know, actually, what its true click-through rate is going to be. So, yeah, then you still need to make a decision as a business, what are you going to do? So this is the Bayesian way of dealing with uncertainty. Well, you don't know what to do. You just take samples, and based on those samples, you calculate some metric that you want to optimize as a business, and you base your decision on that, but not just on one single point from these axes, but from the whole distribution. So then we get to inference, basically how we get to these distributions given data. And I will start with an exact case where we can do all the calculations exactly, and then I will try to find out what's behind that and how we can generalize it to more complex ones. So here we say we have the conversion rate again, and say initially we assume that we don't know anything about the conversion rate. It could be anything. Maybe nobody converts, maybe everybody converts. Maybe it's somewhere in between. We just give everything equal probability. The thing then is that we start to actually draw visitors to the page, and we see the actual conversions. So, I thought I had to rename everything. Here, this is after 4 clicks and 6 bounces, and so you still see that it's no longer flat. It has become a bit, it has a bit more shape, a bit less wide. And then if you have seen many more visitors, then it becomes even more pronounced. So the distribution will get smaller, narrower and narrower, and ultimately will, in the limit of infinite data, you only get this one point back. But well, you don't have infinite data. You can take everything into account. So here's the math. It's actually very simple. Your theta is the conversion rate. So the probability that somebody clicks is theta. Say that somebody doesn't click, it's 1 minus theta. And here we can do everything exactly. Say you have a prior, and in this case I can assume it's constant. We have a likelihood, and then we have a posterior distribution. That's the probability of a particular conversion rate given all the data. And yeah, here the N and M are the clicks and the bounces. So you can see that the powers are increasing, and that basically means that the distribution is getting narrower and narrower. And you can see that there's a nice interplay between the prior, so the things you assume upfront without seeing any data, and the actual data, which is the likelihood. And the way this generalizes is that it's very, very easy actually to generate data. And you have some kind of idea about how the data is generated, given some things that you don't actually observe, but you assume are there. So you should assume that there's this constant click-through rate, theta, and then you have this model that says, well, if conversion rate is theta, then probably that somebody will click is this, and will bounce is that. And then the goal of inference is to do the reverse. So if you have seen the data, then you can make some statements about theta, about the things you haven't seen, but you want to know, actually, because that's what you use to make the business decision. So then we get into more complex models, where we don't have this nice exact solution, where you would write down the code to generate the data, but you wouldn't know how to go back. So if you want to do an exact inference, then there's only a very limited number of models that you can use, and those are the models that you would typically find in your machine learning libraries. You'll find the logic, logistic regression, you'll find a linear regression, you would find all kinds of clustering and other things. But that's really a finite set, and it's not specific to your case. You have to do a lot of hard work to map your domain onto that particular model. It would be much easier if you could just write down your model. So exact inference is if you have a complex model, it may even not even be possible. If it is possible, then it's going to be completely different than the model. And you have to really be careful when actually deriving the inference in math, and then even more careful when implementing it in code. So it's a lot of difficult steps, and it actually makes the model development very, very tedious. And in practice, you wouldn't actually do it. I mean, you would try it for one or two variants of a model that will be just a bit more complex than the simplest thing you can imagine. But then you run out of time, and you basically stop improving. So, how would we now then go about implementing a generic program on in this way? And then the thing that actually that you then need, that is essential for this probabilistic programming, is the random variables. So you saw in the initial code that we sampled the rain, and we sampled the sprinkler and we observed the wetness of the grass. Those are the random variables that are specific to probabilistic programming and that we need to take into account and that we need to find a solution for. So this is where we want to build graphs of, because that's going to be used by our inference algorithms. So how we model this in code, we have basically two new functions, sample and observe, and both are very non-functional. Sample gives you a random number if you have a continuous distribution, or it gives you a random Boolean if you have a Boolean distribution. So no referential transparency or whatever. Observe is a pure side effect. You have to give it a distribution, you give it a value, and that's it. So it's very non-functional. So I've tried very maybe more of you have seen the Noel Welsh video about doing functional programming and probabilistic programming in one, but I couldn't imagine how to get it to work and to join the two. But I could imagine using these. So that's what I'm going to do. So we have the distribution. You saw the distribution here. We need that for both the sampling and the observations. There's also the guide. I'm going to come back to that later. So the distribution can just it can give you a sample and it can observe values. So then I get to the inference part. And there's lots of different kinds of inference. The more fancy ones, Monte Carlo, Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. You have some simpler ones, Gibbs sampling. I'm looking into variational inference, which is an approximate solution for inference, but one that scales well, that works in high dimensions with lots of variables, and one that makes an approximation to the actual posterior distribution rather than an exact sample. This also makes it very fast, and that's what you would typically want in a situation where you apply this to a big data problem. The thing behind variational inference is that you basically try to eliminate all the observations, because those make it hard to sample from the model. If you only have samples, then it's very easy to generate a sample from the posterior, because you just sample all the variants in order and you have your sample. In variational inference, you try to modify the distributions of the random variables such that they actually model, they give you the posterior with the observations basically folded into them. So in variational inference, you would approximate distributions. The actual distribution might be very, very complex, very high dimensional, very weird dependencies between all variables. And you would just approximate this with something that you can manage and that is hopefully good enough. And here is one example. Here I have the beta distribution, which is the distribution for the clicks. And here I approximate it with a normal distribution followed by a sigmoid transformation. And you can see, it's very different distributions, but this one is easy to use variational inference. The other one is not. And still you can use one to approximate the other quite well. So the way I'm then modeling this in Scala Infer is by introducing variables. The variable class, which has a value, so that you can get with a get. And it has a node in the Bayesian network. So you have the triangle of the rain, the sprinkler, and the wet. That's basically the network. And again, not very functional, but I guess it does function. It does work for me. And here you can see that I have the model score, which is the model, the original model. The guide score, which is just the approximation that I'm using. And I can add an observation and all the dependent variables to basically build the whole graph to do the calculation. And then we get to how to actually get the distributions to be similar, and we need some gradients for that. So what you can see here is the actual probability of the normal distribution. So I should have explained this. A normal distribution has two parameters. It has an average value, and it has a weight, the sigma. And based on that, you can calculate the probability that a particular value is observed. And this is the logarithm of that probability. So you have a sigma and a mu, so the average value and the variance. And you see a particular value. And then you construct a graph of all the operations that you need to do on the inputs to calculate the final result, the log sigma minus d squared over 2. And this is then the graph that we need for our gradients. So we calculate this for the model, we calculate this for the guide, and then we compare them by taking gradients. And to take gradients, we basically go in the reverse order. This is the old high school the chain rule. So if you look at the top, that's the forward mode. You have an x, and then you calculate the g of x, and then you calculate the f of g of x. So that's basically continuous transformations of x. And then for the autodiff, you go do it in the reverse. So it's basically doing you start from the right, you give it the value 1, and then you take the derivative first of f. So the derivative of f adds the point g of x, and that's the value that you're going to pass to the node before you. And then you notice, well, I had a variable, or I had a input that was g, so I need to go back further. And you give, you then have as gradient g, the derivative of g, which you have to multiply by the value you already had. So then you end up with the chain rule, but it's a bit different how you would evaluate in high school. But it turns out that this is very efficient to do in when you have such a graph. This is also typically what you would do in a neural network. The backpropagation is exactly this. A bit more complex case, if you have two inputs, then you basically propagate back to both of the inputs since you have two partial derivatives. The way we encode this is simple. We have an expression of a particular type. It has a value v. That's the forward mode, and we give it a gradient, dv, and that's the backward mode. And here we can also see what the score is. That's just a double, so the logarithm, it's ultimately a probability, so that's a real value, or a double in this case. Then we do get the situation where you have introduced a variable d, because then you can have multiple reference to the same variable, and then you have to propagate back twice, and then of course you get an explosion of updates, so that's one thing you want to take into account, that if you have this variable, then what you want to do is you don't want to go back from here to these, and then to these, and these, the earlier nodes, and do the same here again, because then you would update these the earlier nodes a lot of times. So what you want to do is you want to collect all the gradients here first, and then you would also only want to backpropagate. So that's one of the problems that the backpropagation for the implementation should solve. So then we get into the solution I came up with, and that's Scala macros. Since I have the code on the left, that's how I would want to ideally write my model. It's just a piece of a Scala code. It's very imperative, procedural, how you want to call it. You just sample from a distribution, you give it a guide, it's very natural. The forward mode is just like generating data. But then under the hood, I want to transform this into code that actually takes that builds up the graph of the random variables. So rather than having just a Boolean, whether it rained or not, this function should accept a variable of Boolean. Namely, it should also have the node in the Bayesian network node. And it should basically attach all the things that depend on the on whether it rained or not to that node. So I'm not sure if it's good to see, if you can see it in the back, but here is I also change the implementation of sample. So where before I would just get the value, here sprinkled has turned into a variable. It now also has a Bayesian network node with all the dependencies attached to it. So then I need to tell the rain node that it has this dependency, the sprinkler, and it need to add the scores to it. So this is what the macro implementation then actually does behind the hood. It just takes this function, looks at the Scala abstract syntax tree, and then munches through it and generates the code on the right. So that was what we needed to to build the Bayesian network. And similarly, we have the backpropagation problem. We have the double gradients going backwards. And the problem is basically introduced by this file that we have. We give a particular expression, we give it a name. And that allows us to reuse the same expression multiple times, but it also then complicates the backpropagation. So what I do here is I take the expression as it is and then create a buffer out of it, and that will then stop all the backpropagation. And only when I'm then complete, so when I'm going back through the model from the and I've created the sample, and then going back in the backpropagation, and I've completed everything that depends on this Y, then I will only propagate the gradient further. Finally, what then happens? How you would then use this is you would have a function that produces an X, so this could be any block basically. And you'll give it to a keyword infer, and we'll get a model out of that, and we can sample from it. And if you do that a number of times, then we get actual samples from the posterior. Yeah, I think this is about the end of the presentation. I just wanted to show one more slide for the reading. And that's it. So if you have